Let us join together now for our call to worship, which is based on Psalm 118. This is a day the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
The Lord is our strength and our song. He has become our victory.
You are our God, and we will praise you. You are our God, and we will exalt you.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His faithful love endures forever.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this day with so many things of which we are witnessing firsthand within our lives. And some of these things, Lord, are wonderful and cause us to rejoice. However, there are also far too many things that cause us fear that seems to leave us with anxiety. So, Lord, we come to you this day in need of healing. So we ask for your healing touch. So this morning, as we worship you, may the weary find rest and the strong be renewed. May we find peace and be inspired through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And now let us lift our voices up together in reciting that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn of praise, of course, will be shown on the screen, as well as can be found in our hymnals on page 268. So if you will please all stand with me as we sing together, The Risen Christ. Be seated. And now, if you please join with me in reciting our prayer of confession. Lord God, you made the hearts of the disciples glad with the knowledge of the resurrection of Jesus, your Son. Forgive us because, like them, we find the truth so hard to believe. Forgive us that we are so easily downcast and given to despair. Forgive us that although we claim to live by the resurrection faith, we so often appear to believe that suffering is simply a tragedy and that death is the end. Forgive us that we take so much convincing of the hope that you give to the world. Forgive us when we approach you begging for guidance and direction, but then neglect to follow your instructions. Lord, search our hearts as we quietly now bring them before you, as we pause to silently confess our sin and ask for forgiveness. Brothers and sisters in Christ, hear this word of the Lord and rest in this truth. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. If you are in Christ, be assured that God forgives you completely. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let us join our voices once again for our hymn of assurance, which also will be shown again on the screen as well as can be found in our hymnals on page 269. And if you're able, let us all stand and sing, He Lives.
Just the time I need him, he's always there.
be seated. We now come to our time for our people's prayer. And once again, we thank all of you for sharing your prayer requests by internet. We add them to our list each week. And we also thank you for sharing the blessings, for we know that God is always answering our prayers. So with that being said, let us bow our heads now in prayer. Dear God, you are a loving and merciful God. We come before you this day fresh from a week in which we have been challenged. And some of those challenges have caused us worry and strife. And other challenges bring us to clear directions for our lives. In all of this, Lord, you are with us, bringing healing and bringing peace in our lives day to day. Lord, there remains a terrible amount of separation currently within our nation. Many people are happy, and many people are sad. We lift up in prayer our past president and family. We also lift up in prayer our present president and family. Ultimately, it is you who is the true leader of all nations. And we should all find comfort in this fact, because in spite of us, your will be done. So please, Lord, help our nation. Help all peoples to heal. Also, please help all of our leaders, new and old, to lead as you put upon their hearts to do so. We also offer up to you names that were shared by email, names that have been shared by text message, some that were shared verbally. All of these, Lord, we know have already been brought to you, and you know every name on their list, and also, Lord, every hair on their head. And also, Lord, we currently come here this morning with names that are on our hearts of those whom are ill or whom may have felt lost and are mourning someone, those that may feel alienated or wondering if anyone even cares about them. And also, dear God, those that we now silently lift by name to you. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Bring your healing mercies to all of these people. We also bring to you, loving God, names and situations of great joy and great celebration, for you have been in our midst during these times as well. And Lord, it is in total confidence of your abiding love and mercy that we offer this prayer to you this day, all for your glory and your praise, all in the name of Jesus, the Christ, our Lord. Amen. And at this time, even though we won't physically be taking a tithe and offering collection, please note that we appreciate all of the support for the ministry here at Grace EPC. And we do have in the back of our narthex a couple plates for your offerings as well as tithes. And also on our website, we have an online opportunity as well as you can mail it here to the church.
I hear the sound.
Dear Lord, for the blessings of this and all our days, we thank you. Accept, we pray, not only just this money, but also our lives freely offered in gratitude for all you have done for us. Use them both, Lord, for this place and for your ministry everywhere. Amen. You may be seated. Our call of confession once again this morning will be the Apostles' Creed. And please note again, it's updated. And I don't know if all y'all are having the same issue I'm having, but I, of course, had memorized the other older version. And I still, even though we've done this numerous times as far, have to concentrate on reading it. And even then, I have a tendency to kind of swap a few of the words once in a while. So please join with me in reciting the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the living. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I did hear a few quicks out there instead of the living. Just so you know, I caught you. So at this time, we'll have our Old Testament reading.
Good morning. I'm going to be reading from Isaiah 52, verses 13 to 15, and Isaiah 53, verses 1 to 12. I can do something with this. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up, and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Jack. Isaiah is an amazing book. When I was in Bible college, a professor that I prayed that I would be able to have a class under, Dr. Snyder, decided at the last minute this one semester that he would dedicate one full semester on teaching Isaiah. The first time we gathered, he stood before us, which had to be the biggest classroom. It was actually our chapel gathering room in our college because so many people signed up for this class. And he stood before us just shaking his head, and he said, I always prayed to God never, ever to be required to do a class and teach this book because there's so much there. And Isaiah stands at the peak, I truly believe, in the Old Testament as just literary genius of all the prophets of Israel. In fact, his book is the longest of all the prophets and looks farther into the future than any of its contemporaries. Dr. Kyle M. Yates, an Old Testament scholar over 50 years ago, wrote this about the Isaiah passage of Scripture that Jack just read for us. This passage message is at the heart of the gospel. Like Mount Everest, Isaiah 53 stands out in beauty and grandeur, but only because it reveals Jesus Christ and takes us to Mount Calvary. In this particular passage, we see the personal Messiah who alone can atone for sin. But yet his message is rejected, his person is refused, and his mission is misunderstood. But nevertheless, his vicarious suffering would bring atonement between God and man. And though he would suffer death and burial, he would ultimately be exalted. So yes, the servant that Isaiah describes is the Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One. And the New Testament affirms that this servant Messiah is, in fact, Jesus of Nazareth. Now, over the last few weeks, as we've studied the Apostles' Creed, and we know that it has been admired, memorized, and, of course, confessed in worship due to its simplistic in form, as well as clear statement of factual belief and its brief summary of vital core theological points. Well, this morning, we'll be concentrating on the third day he rose again from the dead. And it is of utmost importance for Christians to believe that Jesus rose from the dead. Now, as said, all of the Apostles' Creed is vital, so I don't want to overstate this line's high status. But it is true that if Jesus didn't rise again from the dead, then all is in vain, because he's not who he said that he was. And his death wouldn't have accomplished what that he said that it would. Now, our sermon scripture this morning can be found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And we're going to split it into two portions in this 15th chapter, 1 Corinthians, verses 1 through 8, as well as 12 through 22. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 8, verses as well as 12 through 22. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity we have to be able to gather together and worship you. We thank you for this opportunity to read your word as well as proclaim it. So, Lord, we pray that as your word is read and as it is proclaimed, that by the power of your Spirit, you would open our hearts, our minds, and our ears, as well as our eyes, to hear and see what you want us to learn this day. Amen. Now, the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, and he clearly demonstrated that Christ had, in fact, rose from the dead. So let's begin by looking at the first 8 verses of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. This is the word of the Lord. Now the resurrection stands at the very heart of Christianity. And in keeping the main thing, the cross is extremely important. But the fact remains that it would have been useless without the resurrection which followed. It is so central that the whole Christian calendar is centered around it. You see, the Jews worshiped God on the Sabbath, which was the last day of the week, Saturday, due to the fact that God rested on the seventh day of all of creation. Now, we worship on the first day of the week, Sunday. This is because the early Christians used to meet together on the first day of the week to celebrate and remember the resurrection. Let us now continue in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, looking at verses 12 through 22. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. This is the word of the Lord. What if there is no resurrection? What if Christ remains dead today? Well, the Bible says then that our preaching is in vain and our faith is in vain. There's nothing to preach about since Christ, who claims to be the Son of God and our Savior, cannot even overcome death. And so our faith then is useless. Because after all, why would anybody believe in a dead man? Could this dead man help us today? Could he reach out and touch us and comfort us or heal us? What if there was no resurrection? This is a very serious question because it concerns us this day. If there's no resurrection, it means there is no life. Death cannot be overcome. Life is terminated for good. So that means that no one will ever come back to life, and no one will. Everyone will remain dead forever. And the Bible defines that as being separated from God forever in hell. No life. Death would be the ultimate terminator. It would be the end of Christ, and it would also be the end of every one of us. Because you see, if Christ had not been raised, it means he had no power over death. It means that God has no power over death. It means that death would in fact be the greatest force in all of the universe. It would mean that we have no hope beyond the grave. If death conquered Jesus, it would mean that death would conquer us too. Have any of you ever seen the film that was released in 2014 titled God's Not Dead? Well, it's kind of ironic because when that was first released, all of the critics gave it absolutely terrible negative reviews. They said, this is going to go nowhere. But praise God, because ironically, it ended up grossing over $62 million and only it was a budget of $2 million to create it. In fact, ironically, it was so successful, in 2016, there was a sequel that followed it that was God's Not Dead 2. And then in 2018, there was another sequel called God's Not Dead, A Light in Darkness. For those that didn't see it, it was about a college student named Josh Wheaton, who was also an evangelical Christian. And he rolls in a philosophy class taught by a professor, Jeffrey Radisson, an atheist. Well, Radisson, he demanded that every single one of his students sign a declaration that God is dead in order for them to get a passing grade. Well, Josh, he was the only student within all of his classes that particular year to refuse to sign that. Well, Radisson, he requires Josh then to debate this topic with them, but agrees to let all of his classmates decide who won. Well, in the first two debates, Radisson, he has counter arguments for every one of Josh's points. In the final debate, Josh halts his line of debate with this question to Professor Radisson. Why do you hate God? Well, Radisson, he explodes in rage, and he's confirming that the reason he hates God is this reason, because of his mother's death. Well, this is where it really gets interesting, because then Josh, he asks Professor Radisson another question. He asks him, how can you hate someone that does not exist? Well, what's interesting is that, did you know that this film was based on a book? Well, the book's title is God's Not Dead, Evidence for God in an Age of Uncertainty. And this book was written by a Tennessee minister by the name of Rice Brooks. Well, Pastor Brooks, he was asked this question. He was asked, why did you decide to write about the evidence for God's existence? And this was his reply. You hear these statistics that churches aren't really growing through evangelism. There's not really an engaging of people with the gospel message. I came to the conclusion this rise of the nuns, the religiously unaffiliated, was in fact that basically people didn't really believe the story was true. So then in 2012, there was a song by the Newsboys called God's Not Dead. Well, I decided to have a conversation with them and said, hey, you've got to give kids more of an understanding of why God's not dead. So then I continued to work on a couple projects, and then I just said, I'm going to write this out. So I'm going to write out the evidence of God. Well, then Pastor Brooks was asked this follow-up question. What do you hope readers will take away from your books? He says, if Christianity is true and God exists and Christ is real, then it's something that you can base your life on. If it's not, then I'm not trying to say that ethics and some of the philosophical teachings wouldn't be valuable, but in essence, this is not certainly worth basing your whole worldview on. It's really the only religion that puts the weight of its truth on one event, the resurrection. It really stands and falls on that. The third day, he rose again from the dead. Well, it's really interesting because in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Christ says here that he is raised, but it's interesting that Paul says seven times that Christ has been raised. And glory be to God, because Christ's resurrection makes possible our own resurrection. He is the firstborn, the firstfruits of all those who die. So in other words, the rest will follow. The harvest of the crop will follow. There is more to come. It guarantees that all of those who believe in Christ will be resurrected. The 14th verse, we read, everything that we believe in today rests on this verse. For the Bible says, if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. This is the foundation of the Christian faith. Because without the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we're all fools. We're being deceived into believing a lie. But that is not true. We know it is not true. Even in the Gospel of Matthew in the 28th chapter, right, the 6th verse, the angel said this, he is not here, for he has risen as he said. We come to know that all that Jesus has said came true. The tomb is empty. And when we put our trust in Jesus, we experience a change. We find true meaning and purpose of life. We know what he said is true. Now, one Sunday morning, a pastor was dressing for church, and he had his radio turned on. And as he was listening, suddenly he heard, it's Easter, and it doesn't make any difference if Christ be risen or not. Well, shocked, A.H. Ackley shouted, it's a lie. He is risen. Well, then his wife, and all of us know how our wives are, they're a lot smarter than us 99% of the time, she said this, why don't you write a song about it? Well, then, reading the Gospels again, led by the Spirit of God, he began writing, I serve a risen Savior who's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. Peggy, that's why I don't sing in that part. So yes, Jesus Christ conquered death. And he said, because I live, you also will live. And that is our guarantee. That's why we don't have to worry about death. Because we're going to be with Jesus in heaven. And he guarantees that. In the 19th chapter of Job, Job said this, for I know that my Redeemer lives, and at last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see God. In closing, if there is no resurrection, it means there is no hope. We are all still lost, lost in darkness, lost in sin. Verses 17 and 18. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you're still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. Man will remain lost. Lost without hope. Life will be very dark. There'll be no future whatsoever after the grave. We'd be lost in this darkness. We wouldn't know why we're here. We wouldn't know what life is about. We wouldn't know what is going on or where we're going to go. And as we look around, all people long for something beyond death. All people want to believe that there is something more. They want to believe that their loved ones will continue living on somehow, somewhere, in some new way. But who is anyone that could possibly do that? Who can say that there is life after death if people die? Well, Jesus can, because he came to this world and he introduced himself as that light. And he said, I am the light of the world. And if Jesus is not alive today, then this light has gone out for good. And if that light has been extinguished, there would be no light left in us either. Verse 20. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. Glory be to God, because that light continues to shine and there is hope for us. So if the resurrection is true, we are guaranteed of two things. First, we will have eternal life with him. And second, we can also hope in this life Because you see, no matter what happens, no matter what changes take place within this current world, Jesus, our living Savior, is right here with us. Christ is not a dead Savior. He rose from the dead. He is our living Savior. Because with certainty, we can say, on that third day, He rose again from the dead. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank You for loving us and dying for us on the cross. You are our living Savior and You are our living God, now and forever. We believe that You rose from the dead and that You are alive today. And God, You are our Father and we are Your children, all because of Jesus Christ. Thank You for filling our hearts with Your love, Your peace, and Your joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn can be found on page 277. If you all please stand with me, if you're able, sing He is Lord. For our final blessing. We have sung hymns, we have prayed, we have read God's word. May all y'all now go in peace, and may God, who through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ has given us victory, grant to you new life this day. Indeed, may the power of the resurrection come upon you and transform you all your days and nights, both now and forevermore. Amen. May God bless all y'all and have a wonderful week, everyone.